cute. I love that song. And it's called He'll Be Here?
That's right, Miss Nancy. And I sang in my big girl voice. It's a good song. It tells us that we have to be ready because someday Jesus is going to return.
And what's he going to do when he returns?
He's going to be king over the whole earth. He's going to be king of all other kings.
Very good, Susie Q. Say, where's Buckaroo Bob?
Someone told me he doesn't feel well today.
Well, maybe we can get him out here to talk to us. And do you think you could call him?
Okay. Buckaroo.
You know, I don't think he can hear you that when you call that quietly.
Maybe the other folks could help us call Buckaroo. Do you think you folks could help us call Buckaroo?
Will you help us? On a count of three.
One, two, three.
Buckaroo!
What? Who's calling? Hey, look who's here. All my friends from the internet.
Buckaroo, I notice you have a little cut on your finger. Did you hurt your hand?
I sure did, yeah.
Miss Nancy, why don't you kiss Buckaroo's boo-boo?
Of course I will. Here. Mwah. Now, how did you get that little cut?
Well, just a minute ago, I was flying my paper airplane and it flew into the bathroom and it landed right behind the toilet. And I was crawling all over that there commode trying to reach back there and get it. And that's when I cut my finger.
Oh, yuck!
Buckaroo!
That was real nice. Thank you. Now, what's this about you aren't feeling very well today, Buckaroo?
Yeah, I just don't feel good.
Well, what's wrong with you today?
Well, you know, I got a bunch of cats.
That's right. I hear you have 12 cats.
Yeah, almost a dozen.
And I like playing with them.
Oh, yeah, and they're good cats.
Yes, there's Mindy and Fluffy and Josie and Petunia. Petunia's the one with only three legs, and half her left ear is missing.
Buckaroo, why is half of Petunia's left ear missing?
I bought her from Mike Tyson.
Buckaroo!
Well, tell us more about your cats.
Well, you know, it's a lot of work to take care of that many cats.
I can imagine.
Yeah, you got to feed them. You got to change their litter box every day.
Yeah, that's a lot of work.
Yeah, and yesterday I washed them, and my tongue is still sore.
Buckaroo!
Let's get back to why you don't feel well today.
Okay, my stomach hurts because Susie Q and I were playing school this morning.
Why would that make your stomach hurt?
Because Buckaroo is a bad student.
Susie Q, why would you say that?
Well, let me show you. Buckaroo, let's pretend we're in class.
Oh, yeah, I know. You're the teacher, and I'm just a student.
That's right. Now, Buckaroo, can you use the word mayonnaise in a sentence?
Oh, yeah. That's an easy one.
Okay, Mr. Smarty Pants, use mayonnaise in a sentence.
Sure. Let's see. Mayonnaise a lot of people here tonight. Yeah.
Buckaroo!
I can see how that would give you a stomach ache. I'm kind of getting one myself.
All right, Buckaroo, let's try this one more time. Can you use the word omelet in a sentence?
Omelet? Yeah, that's an easy one.
Okay, Mr. Smarty Pants, use omelet in a sentence.
Sure, here goes. After I accidentally broke the window with my baseball, my cousin Bubba Ray said, I'm going to let you get away with this time, but next time you're going to pay for it.
Calm down, Susie Q, but I think we've had enough of playing school for now. Is there any other reason why you're not feeling well, Buckaroo?
Yeah, my stomach hurts because I was over at Yankee Dan's house this morning.
Yankee Dan?
You remember Yankee Dan. He's in our school. He's always telling me and Buckaroo that we're only in the second grade. And Yankee Dan says, I'm in the fourth grade. You better listen to me. And he's always getting sent to the principal's office.
Yeah, he's a new kid in our school. He moved in a couple blocks away. He used to live in Chicago.
Ah, yes. He's the one who stole the baseball from Walmart.
That's right. And he rides a pretty red bike.
Well, actually, he's got three bikes. A red one, a blue one, and a silver one.
Wow, his mom and dad must be rich.
No, they're not rich. It's just that Yankee Dan gets whatever he wants. Anytime he wants something, all he's got to do is ask for it.
How does that work? When I ask my mom and dad for stuff, I don't always get it. They tell me no all the time.
Well, what he does is he has a fit.
A fit? What's a fit?
Miss Nancy, do you know what a fit is?
Oh, yes, I know what a fit is.
Yeah, when he has a fit, he falls down on the floor, and he yells and screams, he kicks his feet, he pounds his hands up and down. Oh, and when he does it, it's just awful.
Did he do that while you were over at his house?
Yeah, yesterday he told his mom he wanted a Darth Vader action figure, so she said they'd have to wait till payday, and Yankee Dan got mad and had an awful fit.
Ooh, what happened then?
His mom said, okay, Dan, let's go down into the minivan and go to the store.
Really?
Yeah, You know, it seems like every spoiled kid I know has a mom who's got a minivan. Well, anyway, he said, Buckaroo, his mom said, it's time for you to go home so I can take Dan to Toys R Us.
Did you leave?
No, not right away. I tried to leave, but Yankee Dan had another fit because he said he wanted me to go with him to Toys R Us.
Well, did you go with them?
No, I just wanted to get out of there. I don't like seeing Yankee Dan have a fit. It's awful to be around some kid who's having a fit. It gives me a stomach ache.
I wouldn't like that either.
But, you know, I wonder if having a fit will get you more toys, maybe I should start having a fit with my mom and dad.
Really? Do you think that would work?
I don't know, but maybe I should give it a try. Miss Nancy, do you think I should have a fit in front of my mom and dad to see what happens?
Let's think about this. What do you think your mom and dad would do if you had a fit because you wanted a bunch of expensive toys?
Well, my mom and dad would say they'd rather save the money so I could go to college someday.
Do you think you're going to college someday?
Well, I don't know. My brother says I'll be lucky to get into a trade school. I wonder what he means by that.
Never mind that. Tell me about your mom and dad buying you expensive toys.
Well, they say these toys cost a lot of money, and I think my mom and dad would rather save the money in case the air conditioner gets broke or if our car needs new brakes or something.
You know, I think you're right, but let's also ask this question. Would it be the right thing to have a fit to get in order to get your own way?
No, I don't think so.
Well, why not? Why don't you tell us, Buckaroo?
Well, because,
You don't know.
Oh, I know.
Okay, tell us why, Susie Q.
Because the Bible says to honor your father and your mother.
That's right. And what does it mean to honor your father and your mother?
It means that you don't talk back to them. You don't lie to them. You go to bed when they tell you to. You take out the trash when they tell you to, and you feed the dog when they tell you to.
That's right. How about you, Buckaroo? What else does it mean to honor your father and your mother?
Well, I guess it means you don't pitch a fit when they don't buy you a bunch of toys that you want.
That's right. Buckaroo, do you think your parents tell you no just to be mean to you?
Oh, no, no. My parents don't try to be mean to me, no.
And Susie Q, do your parents tell you no because they want to see you sad?
No, my parents love me. I have the best daddy in the whole world.
I know what you mean, Susie Q. Now, you know the Ten Commandments tell us a lot of things like not to steal and not to lie and to keep the Sabbath day holy. Well, the fifth commandment, which we find in Exodus 20, verse 12, says to honor your parents. And do you know that it also gives us a good reason to honor our parents?
It gives us a reason to honor our parents?
Yeah.
Yeah, does it say the reason is so they won't spank you?
No, the reason is because...
Does it say the reason is so they won't send you to bed without dessert?
No, that's not it.
How about this? Does it say the reason is so they won't give you a timeout or so they won't make you stand in the corner? I will obey my parents 100 times or so they won't take away your allowance?
No, it's nothing like that.
Then the reason must be... Oh, I'm sorry. Well, please tell us, Miss Nancy.
Thank you. The Bible tells us that we should honor our fathers and mothers so that we can have a long, full life.
What? You mean I'm supposed to honor my parents because it's good for me?
Yes. It's not for your parents. You obey this commandment because it's good for you. God blesses us when we honor our parents, so let's not be like Yankee Dan. When our parents tell us no, let's not get mad and have a fit. Let's try to always remember that our parents want what is best for us, and so does God. Let's remember that God expects our parents to teach us right from wrong and to provide for our needs, especially when we can't provide for ourselves. Our parents sometimes have to tell us no, and we should be happy that they are doing their best to provide for us and to teach us. Our lesson for today is this. Honor your father and your mother so you can have a long life. I think you guys should practice that with me. I'll say it again first, and maybe the group here can do it too. Let me say it again. Honor your father and your mother so you can have a long life. Now let's all do it together on a count of three. Are you ready? One, two, three.
Honor your father and your mother so you can have a long life.
Thank you. That was very good.
All right then. I'm not going to have fits to get what I want.
You better not.
Well, you know, I got to go visit my grandma and my grandpa. I love to go visit my grandma and my grandpa. When I go to their house, I always give them a big hug and a kiss. Hey, any of you kids ever go visit your grandma and your grandpa? Right.
Ever?
Raise your hand.
Yeah. Raise your hand. Yeah. Yes,
oh,
they do.
Good. A lot of them.
I do.
Good. Because when you go visit them, I hope you always give them a big hug and a big kiss. I got to go now. But before I go, remember what I always say sometimes. Have a good Sabbath. Can you all say that with me on the count of three? 1, 2, 3.
Have a good Sabbath.
Wow!
Susie Q, do you have something you want to say now?
Yep. Will you say it with me?
Of course. Live from Tyler, Texas, it's Bring On the Sabbath!
Bring On the Sabbath. A production of the Church of God International. Broadcast live from Tyler, Texas. Featuring Wes White, Nancy White, Jeff Reed, and the cast of Buckaroo Bob's Neighborhood. Now here is your host, Wes White.
Good evening, and thank you so much for being with us for our sixth Bring On the Sabbath. Last week we did our broadcast from Lexington, Kentucky, and tonight we're back in our studios at Tyler, Texas. And you know, we're really glad to be home. Lexington was great, but we're Texans and we like being back in Texas. Now, I've got to say, the food was great at the Winter Family Week. It was just wonderful. And I'm sorry to say that the food is not so good here at the CGI cafeteria. I mean, yesterday I went down to eat at the CGI cafeteria and I asked what the special was for that day. And the cook just looked at me and she said, carp. Well, I really don't care for carp, so I said, carp was on the special yesterday and the day before that. And she told me, she said, yeah, and it's gonna stay on the special till somebody eats it. Weisenheimer. Star Wars. Everybody's all excited about Star Wars. The new movie's out. I haven't seen it yet. I don't make a big deal out of it like Jeff does. And oh yeah, he's already seen it I don't know how many times. He likes to get into the characters. He likes the costumes. He goes to Comic-Con. Well, I asked him if the movie was any good, and he said that the best part of his Star Wars experience was saying to all the people who work 8-to-5 jobs, I'm going to go to the 10 a.m. showing this morning. So working for CGI has its benefits. Now, I'm going to do a spoiler alert here. So if you don't want the movie spoiled, turn down your volume for just like 30 seconds. Jeff tells me that in the third act of the movie, Carrie Fisher has a piece of spinach stuck in her teeth, and he said it's really distracting. All right, you can turn your volume back up. I understand that CGI, the board of directors, called Jeff in and had a chat with him about his love of Star Wars. And they wanted to talk to him, not about anything like doctrine, anything like that. What they told him was this. They said, if you would put as much effort into your job as you did getting dressed for Star Wars, your mom wouldn't be paying your rent for you right now. Now, today is January 1st, and while our lives in the church revolve around the Hebrew calendar because of the annual high days, we're stuck in the world and we have to be cognizant of the Roman calendar. I mean, that's what everybody uses at work and school everywhere. But we don't make a big deal out of the Roman New Year like they do in the world. When I was a student at Ambassador College in Pasadena, California, I got to see the New Year's Day Rose Parade every year. It was a huge event, and it came right down Orange Grove Boulevard, right past the campus, so we could see everything. And these floats, they were beautiful. And they always had to make the floats out of like flowers or some living matter like seeds or leaves. You couldn't use any plastic or metal or anything artificial for the decorations. Well, one year they had a really bad cold spell in Southern California and the float builders couldn't find enough flowers. So they ended up putting vegetables on the floats for decorations. That's a true story. And then they started to run out of vegetables. They depleted the stocks in all the local grocery stores. So now they're wondering where they can find some more vegetables. So here I am at the time, I'm an undergraduate student at the college, and I recommended, I said, hey, if they need more vegetables,
I suggest that the college donate some of our ministers and faculty. Got called into the dean's office for that one. Now, that was a long, long time ago. Well, not too long ago, I think it was like 3 or 4 years ago? Yeah. Nancy and Wayne and Karen and I went to visit the CGI congregation up in New York City. And we ended up staying an extra day in New York because we wanted to see the New Year celebration up there. Times Square was packed with people. I never saw anything like it. So we're talking to some of the locals, the New Yorkers who live up there. We're talking about watching the ball drop at midnight. You know, they do the countdown and the ball drops. You've seen it on TV. And I said to these New Yorkers, I said, this is going to be great. I've never seen the ball drop before. And one of the New Yorkers said to me, he said, you've never seen the ball drop before? He said, you live in Texas. You see the Cowboys play all the time. Now, for those of you who are into calendars, and I know a lot of you are because I get emails from you all the time, you may already know that they added a leap second to the calendar this year, 2016. And you know, about every 4 years, you know they add a day in February. They add February 29th. We call that leap year. But this year, based on astronomical observations and all the scientific data, they realized that they needed to add a leap second to 2016 to make our clocks more accurate. I don't know what you plan to do with your leap second, but I want to use mine constructively. I want to think about all the good ideas that have been presented in the presidential debates going on right now. The problem is, I don't know what I'm going to do with the rest of that second. We've got a great show for you tonight, and you may get to see it if this monologue hasn't gotten me fired already. We're going to talk about killing in self-defense in our current events discussion. We're going to talk about other current events. We're going to have a Bible study. We want to hear your comments and questions. Talk to us in the chat room. Stick around, Shutsy. We'll be right back.
There's so much controversy today in the United States about healthcare. We hear so many arguments about whether or not we should have a healthcare system which is similar to what the other Western democracies have. How can we improve the medical insurance system we have? Is there any way we can make this situation better? Medical insurance in this country basically started in the 1930s when labor unions were demanding things such as child labor laws, 5-day work weeks, and 8-hour days. And it was after World War II that medical insurance for employees skyrocketed. Today, the healthcare system in this country seems to be in trouble. People on both sides insist that we've got to improve the situation. Hi, I'm Wes White from Connecting History and the Bible at CGI.org. Let's go to Dallas, Texas. I'm standing in front of Baylor University Medical Center. It's the main hospital for one of the world's largest hospital systems, Baylor Scott and White. Baylor recently went to work on the problem of healthcare, and they discovered that they could better serve their employees and save over $14 million a year by implementing new practices within their employee healthcare program. They're now trying to help other companies implement the major aspects of their programs. One of the first things Baylor learned was that 5% of its employees accounted for 50% of medical costs. Joel Allison of Baylor Scott & White has stated that it's not that obesity runs in your family, it's that nobody in your family runs. In other words, preventive medicine and a healthy lifestyle are key to good health and keeping medical care costs down. And this is why it's so important that we not only exercise, it's also important that we eat the right foods in the right amounts. Believe it or not, a lot of what Joel Allison said is backed up by what's in the Bible. The Bible very clearly gives us guidance on eating right foods. Did you know that the Bible tells us that certain animals can be eaten and that certain animals should not be eaten? The Bible also tells us that there are parts of the animal that definitely should not be eaten. For example, humans should not eat the fat of any animal, and humans should not eat the blood of any animal. You probably never heard this, did you? But it's true. The Bible gives us clear instruction on these matters, and if we follow them, we can live healthier lives. And did you know that the Bible talks about the importance of exercise? And it even says things like, you should have a little wine for your stomach's sake. No, the Bible doesn't condone drunkenness, but it does suggest that drinking wine in moderation can be good. Contrary to what some would have you believe, the Bible does not teach that alcoholic beverages are a sin. At CGI.org, we have information on these subjects. Each of us has a responsibility to ourselves when it comes to our personal health. We also have a responsibility to others to try to help keep health care costs down. We all need to work together in peace and love on issues such as this. We'll see you next time on Connecting History and the Bible at CGI.org.
The Bible tells us that we should not forsake the assembling of ourselves together, but some people can't always attend worship service on a regular basis. This happens when people are ill, or if they can't drive, or if they live too far away from other brethren. At the Church of God International, we encourage you to fellowship with like-minded Sabbath keepers. But if you can't attend with others, please feel free to attend with us online. We meet every Sabbath at 11 a.m. Central Time. You may join us by going to the website www.cgi.org. That is www.cgi.org. Experience the love of our Sabbath services. You will hear God's words explained. You will hear music that praises our Heavenly Father and His Son, Jesus Christ. Don't miss out on this opportunity to keep God's Sabbath in a joyful manner. In the early days of the church, there was a great controversy between Jewish Christians and Gentile Christians. A dividing line seemed to have been drawn between converts of Jerusalem's apostles and congregations led by Paul. We know that there was a time when Paul was upset with Peter over issues dealing with the treatment of Gentiles. Was it a situation where Paul taught that the law was done away with? Or was it a situation where Paul taught against a perverse and apostate religion that claimed to represent the teachings of the Old Testament? We would like to offer you a free booklet entitled, The Book of Galatians, A Commentary. It's free. You can get it here at cgi.org. Again, the title is, The Book of Galatians, A Commentary, at cgi.org.
We're back. We're here live in our studios in Tyler, Texas on Bring On the Sabbath.
I'd like to say hello to some of the people that are already online, if you don't mind.
Wonderful, wonderful.
We got Starlight 61, Aspiring.
Starlight.
Oh, Mimi, okay. Bud 57, Joy, Phil and Jeanette, Joy Forever Guy, Pat, Lady Tex, Jeff, Rob, Carl, Jerome, and Super Jim.
Wonderful.
Sorry if I missed anybody. I think I got them all.
Okay. Well, if you didn't get on the roll call, let us know you're out there. We want to hear from you.
Say hello.
And we want to hear your comments. We want to hear your questions. So say something to us. We're glad you're here with us tonight. We've got a good show for you. We're now at the segment we call the Alpha and the Omega, because Jesus is our Alpha and Omega. He changes not. And that means we can't look at any event from the point of view of, well, that's just how the world is now, or this is how the world was back then. No, sin is sin no matter where or when it happens. And we humans tend to try to, quote unquote, put things into context. As Christians, we can't do that. We can't look at things through the lens of time or place or culture or environment. We can only look at things through the prism of Bible teaching. Now,
I constantly call church people out on this issue. Church people will go on and on about how great some guy was in history or how some great recent or current politician is. And I always say, yeah, but what about this? This guy did this or he said that. And frankly, my skin kind of crawls when they say, well, he was or is just a product of his time, or he didn't know better because of the times that he was living in, or he had to go against what the Bible teaches in order to do something good like save the country or do what was best for the people to survive. As a Christian, we can't make these kinds of excuses for mortal men. The Bible doesn't do that. The Bible doesn't pull any punches on sin, no matter who it was who was committing the sin. The Bible calls out guys like Saul and David and Solomon and Jeroboam. On and on we could go. Even the Apostle Peter gets exposed for treating the Jews with more respect than he treated the Gentiles. When a guy in the Bible sins, the Bible says he sinned, or it says he did evil in the sight of the Lord. The Bible makes it very clear that we are not to make excuses for those people that we read about in Scripture. We never say things like, well, King Saul disobeyed God because he was a mover and a shaker and he really wanted to get Israel's business done. No, God told Saul not to sacrifice until Samuel got there, and Saul disobeyed, and God called it for what it was. It was sin. When we start putting people on pedestals, whether they're founding fathers or contemporary politicians or leaders in the church, when we do that, we're playing a dangerous game of making excuses for evil behavior. The only one that we should ever put on a pedestal is Jesus, our Savior. The only one who deserves our praise. Jesus is our Alpha and Omega. We don't have to make excuses for him like we have to for mortal men. And that's what this segment of BOTS is all about, the Alpha and the Omega. We look at things happening in the world not to condemn other people, but to put things into perspective of the Bible, not in the perspective of someone's political views or someone's historical views. Okay. Now, let's talk about the wonderful winter family weekend that we had over the December 25th.
Really good.
Yeah, it was great.
We had a ball there, didn't we?
Yeah. I had a blast. I think everybody I met out there, wonderful. Thank y'all for coming to all the seminars we had in CGI. And we had a booth set up, and people came by, and Buckaroo was there, and it was so much fun.
Yeah, I went to some seminars. They were great.
Now, I'm told there were over 600 people there this year, and I think this was a record. I think this is the highest attendance they've ever had. This is great. And kids, I'll bet over half of the people that we saw there were kids, and this is so wonderful to be around a church gathering that has so many kids. And I can't say enough good stuff about the Winter Family Weekend. And I want to make two important points that relate to the Winter Family Weekend. Now, here's the first thing. Those of you watching, if you have kids, you need to take your kids to events like this where there are so many Sabbath keepers getting together in peace and love and harmony. And I know it can be a financial sacrifice to pack up the family, travel a long distance to an event like this. But this stuff is important for our kids. They need events like this. And parents, it's your job to sacrifice for your kids if you can, and take them to church events where your kids can make new friendships with other Sabbath-keeping kids. And I know people think it's silly for me to start talking about the Feast of Tabernacles now. And I know there are people right out there right now, they say, Wes has been going on and on about getting ready for the feast. They're saying, what's wrong with him? He's already getting excited about the feast. And sure, we've just arrived at the new year. Today's January 1st. But I promote the Feast of Tabernacles early because I know the importance of planning, especially if you've got a family, especially if you've got a job and you've got to take vacation time. If you want to have a great feast, you have to plan for it. If you wait till the last minute to plan for the feast, it's not going to go as well as if you spend some time in preparation. So, brethren out there watching, please start planning now for the Feast of Tabernacles. And if you've got kids, don't be thinking in terms of, well, you know, I'm going to go to this feast site over here off somewhere because they let me preach there. Or I want to go to this one place because I get to see this old friend of mine. your motivation for your feast site should also include what's best for your kids so that they'll come to love church as much as you do. So they stay in the church after they turn into adults. We don't want our kids to hate church and then say, well, as soon as I turn 18, I'm leaving all this Sabbath keeping stuff. So many of our local groups are small fellowships where our kids don't get to interact with other Sabbath keeping kids. So we have to find other ways to do things. We have to always be cognizant and figure out ways to compensate for their not being around kids every Sabbath by picking good feast sites and taking them to places like Winter Family Weekend. And remember what I've said about the good parents. They're the ones who make sure that their kids say the following. Here's what their kids say. I don't feel like I'm missing out on anything when we don't keep Christmas because my parents take me to the feast where I have so much fun with other kids. And this is the kind of rearing that we need to do for our kids. And then when you add something like the Winter Family Weekend to your family life, there's no way a kid is going to feel like he's missing out on not having Christmas. He not only has the feast, he also has other things like Winter Family Weekend. Please make church experience a great thing for your kids where they will be edified and enabled and exhorted and educated and exhilarated. All right, now that's point number one. Now here's the second point I want to make that's related to what we experienced in the Winter Family Weekend. And let's first review something I learned from Ron Dart a long time ago. Ron Dart taught me there are three ways that we know something. First, there's category one. These are things that we can know for sure. They're rock solid. Category one includes things like the promise of eternal life because we've accepted Jesus as our Savior. Things like the seventh-day Sabbath, things like God's annual high days. Again, category number one, stuff we can take to the bank. Category number two includes things that we can safely infer. And in this category are things like here's an example, what we call the age of accountability for baptism. And we in the church teach that before someone gets baptized, they have to be at that age of accountability. Now, what is that age? Mm-hmm. Well, we don't always agree in the church
on that.
It
could be 16, 18, 21.
We don't know. That's right. Everybody has a different interpretation. But the point is the person must be aware of the consequences of covenanting with our Savior Jesus. That's the whole point of this concept of the age of accountability. Now, question. Can we find this term, age of accountability, in Scripture? No, we can't. It's not there. But we believe we can safely infer it because we have absolutely no record of the apostles or John the Baptist baptizing infants. No. That just wasn't done in New Testament times. And why not? Because an infant cannot covenant with God. So we are safely inferring that there must be an age of accountability for anyone who's going to be baptized. Again, that's category number two. Category number three is where we're wading around in the weeds. We're speculating about things that we can't prove or we can't safely infer. We're wondering if maybe this is the case, maybe that's not the case. And during the Genesis Bible studies that I'm doing at Christian Educational Ministries, and you can watch them every Friday night, it's an audio thing. In those Genesis Bible studies, we've tried to be very careful to point out what we talk about. When we talk about certain things, we say, well, this thing we're saying now falls under category one or category two or category three. We try to be very careful.
Right. Mm-hmm.
But now, and again, I learned that from Ron Dart. Now I have some bad news for you because I'm going to add category number four.
You're always adding something.
Always adding something.
That's category, right. All right.
Category number four is falsehoods. Category four can be an outright lie, or it can be a well-meaning misstatement. And I have to bring this up because of something that happened to me and to Nancy and to Jeff at Winter Family Weekend.
Yeah, right?
We all got hit with this.
We all got heard this come up quite a bit.
Yeah. We were asked about Sharia law. And again, not by just one person. And when someone brings up Sharia law to me, I start cringing because I know what's coming next.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And let's interject an important point. Are we on this show defenders of Sharia law or Islam? No, absolutely not.
Sharia law is definitely not a good thing.
We're all about Christianity.
Not a good thing.
I will not defend any religion that does not teach the following. There's only one way to salvation, and that's through accepting Jesus of Nazareth as Savior, King, Lord, Ruler, Messiah, the Word, the firstborn into the God family.
I got to add amen.
Amen.
Amen to that.
If a religion does not promote these things about Jesus, it is a religion that is not going to get you eternal life.
True.
I don't care what that religion is.
Mm-hmm.
But now I got to do a little interjection for those who aren't real familiar with us. Are we saying that if you don't accept Jesus, you're going to burn in hell for eternity?
No.
No, absolutely not. Because our religion teaches things about the immortality of the soul, about hell, and about multiple resurrections that no one else teaches.
Mm-hmm.
And if you don't know our teachings about the immortality of the soul, about hell, and about multiple resurrections, you should contact us and start asking questions, because we've got good news on these subjects.
And I bet we've got booklets.
We actually have booklets on all those subjects.
Yeah, so because we teach good news about this.
Right.
The other religions teach bad news about these subjects.
Sure.
We teach the good news about these subjects. So write to us, call us, email us. And my email.
Yeah, actually, also, you can right here, you're on the website.
Yeah.
Right there. So when you leave,
you can get them right there.
Right there in the chat.
You're there.
All right.
Well, yeah.
Now we put the qualifiers in. Let's get back to what I was told, what we were all three told about Sharia law this last weekend.
Mm-hmm.
Some folks told us that the city of Dearborn, Michigan is under Sharia law.
Yep.
I was there. I actually heard somebody say that. Hey,
so
here,
a city in the United States of America is under Sharia law.
That's what I heard from several people.
That's what I heard.
They told us that there are what they call no-go zones in Dearborn, where police won't go into these no-go zones because the Muslims are ruling those sections of the city and where Islam is enforced on everyone.
Mm-hmm.
They told us that women get harassed in public parks if they don't wear Islamic clothes, whether the woman is a Muslim or not.
Hey, Wes, let me.
Yeah.
Actually, I can tell you where these stories come from. Uh-huh. I'll get to it a little bit later.
Okay.
There's actually an origin for these stories, but it's not from Dearborn.
So okay.
Go ahead.
Oh, wow.
These people told us that liquor store owners in Dearborn, Michigan, are threatened with violence if they don't shut down because alcoholic beverages are forbidden in Islam. And brethren, I can't tell you how heartbroken I was to hear Church of God people making these statements and trying to pass them off as category number one when they're actually in category number four. This is a lie, this stuff about Dearborn, Michigan. Now, some of you out there are thinking, well, how do you know Sharia law is not being enforced in Dearborn, Michigan?
Did you take a trip there?
Yeah, did you go there? People say, well, you live in Texas. Mm-hmm. Well, there are several reasons why I'm making this statement very dogmatically. First of all, I called the Public Information Office of the City of Dearborn after this happened. Mm-hmm. The spokesman for the City of Dearborn assured me this is not being done. In fact, the person asked me for my email address. I gave it to the person. They wanted me to have information in writing that I could quote from the City of Dearborn on this issue. This is an official statement by the City of Dearborn. I'm going to quote. Dearborn is a very welcoming community and a very patriotic one. We have the oldest continuous Memorial Day parade in the state of Michigan, 91 years, and one of the largest Memorial Day parades in the country. We also commemorate Flag Day, Veterans Day, the Korean War Armistice Day, with solemn ceremonies every year. Our schools also hold their own ceremonies on Veterans Day. We are about to build a new Veterans Park. We have a very active interfaith community, very active neighborhood associations, about 90 neighborhood block parties each year where our residents come together for picnics and fun. Dearborn is also home of the headquarters of Ford Motor Company, and we are home to one of the most visited tourist attractions in the nation, which is the Henry Ford Museum and Greenfield Village, which each year attract 1.7 million visitors from around the region, the country, and the world, end quote. That's my first point. My second point is, I then called people in the Church of God who I know who live in Detroit, which is right next to Dearborn.
Actually, and before you talked about that call, there was a person that was, they were talking about the Sharia law up there. So there's people, Detroit's near Dearborn, I think, or close to it. Yeah, right next to to it. So I asked the people in Detroit.
While you were at Winter Fair.
Yeah, while I was at the Winter Fair weekend. I said, hey.
Right there.
People are telling me there's Sharia law in Dearborn. What's going on?
Yeah.
And they said, well, no, actually, like you mentioned, there's a lot of interfaith groups. He said Jews and Muslims and Christians have groups where they try to work together in Dearborn.
Wow, so they all get together. They're not fighting each other. Yeah. They all get together.
Yes, they're not fighting. So I guess because of all of the diversity of the different thoughts and religion, they actually make a point that they have these interfaith groups to do these type of things.
Yeah, so I called Detroit and I talked to two Church of God people, and one of them, if I mention his name, and I don't think he'd mind me mentioning it, but I want to be safe and not. He's actually a minister in the Church of God, and I'll bet everybody that's out there watching, just about everybody, knows this guy. I asked these brothers in Christ who live in Dearborn, Detroit, right next to Dearborn, I said, is Sharia law being enforced in Dearborn? And these two guys in the church were absolutely adamant that it is not. And they both told me how greatly disappointed they are that so many people in the Church of God are making these claims, because my inquiry to them was not the first time they've heard this. They've heard this lie many times before from other people, and they're appalled that Church of God people are promoting this lie. Brethren, when we make a totally untrue statement like this, we are bearing false witness. It's the same as breaking the Sabbath or committing adultery or stealing. We have no business passing along any information unless we're absolutely positive it's true. If we pass along a lie, we are breaking the commandments.
Now, I want to get back to what I mentioned earlier about where this comes from.
Right.
Okay. There are several videos on the internet that show Muslim gangs actually going up and harassing women for what they're wearing, mm-hmm. and trying to enforce Sharia law. And this happened in England. I think it was a couple of years ago. Between 2012 and 2014, there were gangs of Muslims, not everybody in the community, really small, I guess you would say, thugs or just criminal elements that were going around, and they were harassing people. And there was recorded by local news shows in England, and a lot of websites will use these videos and say and try to pass it off as being Dearborn when it actually happened in England.
Well, they should be showing videos of regular homegrown American non-Muslim, non-Christian, non-Jewish thugs, because people do get harassed by gangs in cities like LA and New York and stuff like that.
People do get harassed by gangs. So this is gangs that were made of, and they wanted, and they were really proud of their Islamic heritage, and so they were going around and they were wanting to stop this. But what happened is that England didn't say, hey, we're going to keep this. They actually were arrested and prosecuted, and they're not doing it anymore. This stopped in 2014.
That's good. Yeah.
But these videos are what people are passing off as being what's happening in Dearborn, which is not what's happening. You have to be accurate with the information that's out there.
We have a couple of comments.
Well, let me finish another important point here, and then we'll let you get those comments. I want to put in a very important qualifier that I don't want you to think that this was a prevalent message among the folks at Winter Family Weekend.
No, it wasn't. No.
It was not. It was just a few people who were quite vocal, but it was just a few.
That's true.
I don't believe this is promoted by the sponsors of the Winter Family Weekend and the Cincinnati Church of God, so I don't want to overstate this. But I've got to mention this because this business of spreading misinformation is happening way too much in the Church of God. All right, go ahead, Nancy. You wanted to mention a couple things?
I just wanted to say that Lady Tex is with us on this. She says the hate mongering has to stop. And Carl said Facebook is full of stuff that people share that's not true. That's right. Check it out. Yeah. There's Snopes. There's other ways to check it out. Mm-hmm. Just backing up a little bit, Kivo and Chili 1957 joined us. So, hi. Thanks
Hello.
For coming. And Mimi said to tell you she's ready for the feast. She can't wait.
Excellent. And where's Mimi going for the feast?
She did not say. Maybe she can write us about that. And backing up even further, Carl wanted to know when you were talking about holding even the patriarchs accountable. He said, what about Abraham lying about his wife?
Excellent. Yeah, he did. Well, that's interesting. We're getting way off the subject.
Yeah.
And we want to do a Genesis Bible study here at CGI. But let me just say this. Abraham and Sarah were brother and half brother and half sister.
Right, right.
So it can be argued technically it was only half a lie.
Yeah, that's what he said. It's a half truth. It's a half lie, half truth. It's glass half full, half
exactly.
empty. But I think is the idea that God could not have intervened and saved them if he had not lied. I seriously doubt
exactly.
that.
Exactly. Yeah.
But point.
Yeah. So. I want to bring up something that Carl mentions about lies on Facebook.
Uh-huh.
Okay. While I was up at Winter Family Weekend, I received a Facebook post, and it showed a picture of Osama bin Laden standing side by side with one of the candidates for president.
It had to be a couple of years ago.
I'm not going to say who it was. And in this picture, it was like Osama bin Laden and this candidate were best friends.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
It was photoshopped. Mm. It was a lie. It was bearing false witness. And it was posted on Facebook by a church person. And the sad part is, it wasn't the first time I received it from a person in the church. I had already received it from three other church people in the previous 2 weeks.
Was it always the same candidate?
Yes, it's the same picture.
It's the same picture.
It's the same picture.
Okay. Photoshop them all in.
Yeah, okay.
Brethren, please, this is wrong. This needs to stop. If you're making statements or sending out messages that you can't prove, you need to cease and desist. Now, you know, we're talking now interpersonal relationships, mm-hmm. And that's what Christianity is all about. It's about how we get along with each other. I would like to suggest that we all call out those who send these things, but I've given up on that. Mm-hmm. It doesn't work.
Okay.
People want so badly to believe bad stuff about certain people in politics, you can't convince them of the truth. So what I do now on my personal Facebook page is I don't unfriend them. I used to do that, but now I don't. I just unfollow them mm-hmm. if they're sending this stuff out. We're still friends mm-hmm. on Facebook, but I don't see their stuff. And this is sad because, you know, I'm missing out on the stuff they're writing about their children and their grandchildren.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, can I add something?
Yeah, go ahead.
What I do is like I go to like Snopes.com mm-hmm. or actually somebody, I've seen a lot of stuff on Facebook that people post.
Mm-hmm.
That's absolutely not true, or like, well, is that true? Or I don't know. And you can really just do a quick Google search or find something. And usually, if I can find that it's not, I will post that link underneath where they posted it, just to kind of show them, hey, you know, maybe you should read this. Mm-hmm. Where they're kind of showing this is not true. Yeah. And a lot of things that are happening on Facebook, there are people who are part of, they have fake websites that are like mm-hmm. satire,
mm-hmm.
and so they'll post things like the picture mm-hmm. with the president. They'll post it as news. They'll make a story about it because they want to see how people will. They get really excited when people post it as real because for them, they've done their job because they're trying to fool people.
Right. Like, so you the got, onion.
Like the onion.
The onion.
Like
yeah.
the onion is one of the mm-hmm. popular. There's a lot of them now. Like, you know, people are just making it because yeah. the onion was so
yeah.
popular
yeah.
and people share misinformation.
Love the onion, but you got to know it's satire.
It's satire.
Yeah, it's satire.
Real thing.
Right.
And I have a couple of comments here. Phil says Facebook is filled with a lot of incredible accusations against the president that some religious people seem to relish. I think it's really gone past the scriptural injunctions in the Bible. And he says that our leaders are to be respected, irregardless of whether we agree with their policies or not. That's a great point. And mm-hmm. Mimi says, my thoughts are we need to encourage each other and stop putting the other down when we don't agree with each other. So those are really, really good points.
Yeah, the bottom line to this whole thing is we shouldn't be living lives of negativity.
No.
And if I had to diagnose this, and I could be wrong, but I'm doing my best to diagnose this, I can only conclude that too many people in the church have lost hope. And I'm pretty sure this is true because I hear this from church people all the time. They say, oh, our country is in such bad condition. They have actually lost hope. And when people live in such fear of what's going on in the world around them, it's because too many times they've taken their eyes off the prize, which is Jesus, who is the ultimate in hope. Brethren, we're God's people. We are his family, as we see in Genesis 1, 26 and 27, that we see in Genesis 3, 15. We should be living our lives absorbed with the good news of the restoration of the Garden of Eden that's going to take place after Jesus returns. We should be so happy about the kingdom of God being brought back to the earth that we don't live in fear and dread. Instead, our lives are supposed to be filled with hope, the promise of eternal life with our Savior, the promise of the resurrection, to be born again, to live for eternity. So, brethren, please mm-hmm. keep your eyes on the prize, which is the world tomorrow.
Absolutely, yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right, Nancy, what news event do you have for us tonight?
Well, you know, Wes, you recently passed along a link to an article about a couple that had converted to Jediism. They had become Jedi.
Wait, what did you say?
Jediism.
Okay.
Really?
Star Wars guy. You should love this, Jeff.
Jediism.
They become Jedi. You can become Jedi.
So maybe I may not be here tomorrow. I'm a Jedi.
These are the droids you're looking for.
Not the droids you're looking for. Okay.
People on the internet, this is not the Bring on the Sabbath you're looking for. No, yes, it is. Okay. Well, you can find out details about the religion of this faith on their website. They have a website, templeofthejediorder.org. That's templeofthejediorder.org. And I want to give you just a short overview of the religion that I saw on their website. Jediism is a religion based on the observance of the Force, a ubiquitous and metaphysical power that a Jedi, that's a follower of Jediism, believes to be the underlying fundamental nature of the universe. Jediism finds its roots in philosophies similar to those presented in an epic space opera called Star Wars. It is a religion in and of itself. Now, it's also important that you guys realize that Jedi Order website clearly states that they do not worship George Lucas or Star Wars. But you can't say the same about people who go to Comic-Con.
No.
However, they do base their faith on the tenets outlined in or extrapolated from the movie franchise. And before we laugh too hard, think about friends and maybe family in the church that you know of that have got involved in something that and made a religion out of it. Mm-hmm. Things like sports, routinely giving up time at church events or with brethren or family to watch their team. Politics, a particular politician or a political party, choosing to research more about and focus more of their conversations and social media on politics than on the Word of God. The latest health craze, whether it's essential oils, alternative medicine, health food, giving any of these credit for healing above credit to God.
Now, can we stop there? Can you give an example without giving a city name of somebody giving credit to vegetables instead of to God for healing?
Okay.
Credit to vegetables.
Yeah. Get this now.
We knew an older couple in the church, and she was diagnosed with cancer. I can't remember what it was.
Don't get too
what it was. That's anyway, okay. So they initially went to a doctor, and then they got on a routine of just only raw vegetables.
But prior to that, she had been anointed.
Anointed.
Yeah. Uh-huh. And so it was a doctor's diagnosis, not something that she just felt. Anyway, then when she went back to the doctor, I can't remember if it was on remission or they couldn't even find it, but I think it was in remission. And Wes had said to them, one of the two of them, praise God. And they said, it was the vegetables.
Yeah, they were eating all those vegetables.
It was all those raw vegetables.
And didn't give God the credit.
No.
Yeah.
Okay. Not even God, and not even equal time, God and vegetables. Yeah. And that's extreme, right?
Yeah.
Okay, well, the same can be said about traditional medicine, just going that route and not giving God any credit. But let's move on. Pets, elevating animals or animal welfare to people status or above people status. Your work, job, career, letting it get in the way of truly resting on the Sabbath. Maybe you're thinking about it all the time or regularly keeping you from going to the feast. Let's be clear. There's nothing wrong with having pets, and you better take proper care of them if you've got them. There's nothing wrong with health food, essential oils, eating organic. I own a juicer. I've been to a chiropractor. And I've used essential oils.
Yeah, you use that lavender stuff in your bath every night.
I love the lavender chamomile
smells good.
Bath. Yeah. Yep. Also, it is a fact that most of us need to work, right? We have to work. And we might end up a couple of times getting stuck, you know, not being able to take off for the feast due to circumstances beyond our control. These things in and of themselves are not wrong. But have you ever met someone in the Church of God Fellowship that seemed, you know, by their conversation, by their behavior, decisions, continual focus, to have elevated any of these things to the level of a religion? Mm-hmm. Did they seem to you based on where they spent their disposable income, how they spend their free time, what they wanted to talk about the most, to have replaced God and the Bible as what is first in their lives? You know, I really want to keep from getting, you know, caught in that trap myself. As representatives of Jesus Christ on this earth, as children of God and students of the Bible, it's important that we make God and Christ, the Bible, its history, its wisdom and requirements, the focal point of our lives. For example, if I'm sick, do I do what we're told to do in James 5:14-15? Here's what it says. Is anyone sick among you? Let him call for the elders of the church and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of the faith will save the sick, and the Lord will raise him up, and if he have committed sins, he will be forgiven. Or do I just choose, see an iridologist, go to the chiropractor, essential oils, etc., or do I go chemo, surgery, and all that kind of stuff and not follow this scripture as well? Mm-hmm. Here's another example. After churchy Sabbath, each Sabbath.
Can I make a point about that?
Absolutely.
Come to me. I had cancer. Mm-hmm. 10 years ago, a little over 10 years ago. Mm-hmm. And when I had cancer, the first thing I found out when they did the x-ray and they showed this thing in me about that big, is I called the minister in town, Clint Mahoney. He may be watching, but Clint Mahoney, I called him up and said, Clint, I need to be anointed because I have cancer. And I knew the doctor could do whatever they could do, but I knew the first thing I should do was go find them out and get anointed, because it's very, you know, that's taking this and saying, God, I'm giving it over to you. You know, I put my faith in what you have mm-hmm. for us.
Perfect. So, as I was saying, after church on the Sabbath, you know, what are our conversations about? What do I talk about? Could I speak as passionately and knowledgeably about scripture as I can about my favorite, you know, politician or sports team? Do I worry about the next political vote or about GMOs more than about working out my own salvation with fear and trembling? Do I spend more time on listening to political or news shows or watching sports or reading about the use of some new health trend or binge watching my favorite series on Netflix than I do on the Word of God? I mean, any of us can get caught in that trap. This could also apply to my career, fitness, and some of the other things I said. These things are good in balance, but they should not be elevated to the level of religion. So in 1 Corinthians 1:27, it says, only let your conversation be as it becomes the gospel of Christ. This word translated, let your conversation be, means to behave as a citizen of. And I must make sure that everything I do and say shows me to be a citizen of heaven above all else. All right, only one can save me, and that is Jesus. So let me wrap this up with this from the Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians 2:2. For I determined not to know anything among you save Jesus Christ and him crucified. So may the twin forces of the Holy Spirit and the Word of God be with me and be my guide.
Very good. Thank you, Nancy. Let's see, before we go into Jeff, let's see, we don't have any comments.
Joy Forever guy says that there is a Church of Elvis.
All right.
Church of Elvis, and we have
an Elvis impersonator
watching.
And we have an Elvis impersonator watching.
Yeah, so I don't know if he's part of that church, hope not.
Right, so Rob says, most people don't give credit to God because it's a matter of faith. We of faith know that God does intervene at times. So you're right, mm-hmm. and that's how we should put our focus. There's a few other things here, but I'll let this go so we can get back.
Okay. All right. Save them for later if we have time. And okay. We're running out of time because we've got so much. Yeah. Jeff, what news item do you have for us tonight?
This news item I found on Mashable.com. And it said more people have died last year by taking selfies. You know, taking selfies with their phone than shark attacks.
Oh my!
In the past year, so more people have died from selfies and shark attacks. And here's what it
says. What a statistic that is.
Yeah, and it says a 66-year-old Japanese tourist has died, and his travel companion has been injured after falling downstairs while attempting to take a selfie at the Taj Mahal.
Oh.
The man's death raised the selfie-related death toll this year to 12.
Oh my.
So to put that in perspective, in 2015, there have been so far been 8 deaths caused by shark attacks.
Oh my.
So 12 selfies, 8 shark attacks. And it sounds like a joke, but unfortunately it isn't. The deaths are a tragic reminder to travelers that focusing on a phone screen instead of unfamiliar surroundings is not safe. Since 4 of the selfie deaths this year, like the tourists identified as Hideto Uda, and I know I'm messing that up pretty bad, the name, were caused by falling. The next leading cause of death involved selfies was being hit or injured by trains.
Oh my.
Either because the individual was trying to get a photo with a train, or because the photo they wanted involved getting on dangerous equipment.
Oh my.
So it's not clear if the number of daredevil selfies is increasing, but more and more tourists are making headlines because of dangerous attempts to get a memorable photo. So it's something that's happening. And actually, I've seen quite a few daredevils on Facebook or YouTube.
Oh, really?
There was one daredevil in Russia that I saw. He was on top of a building, and he was up there, you know, very tall, 2,000-foot building.
You sure it wasn't photoshopped?
I don't know. And no, I think it was real. And I saw another one. It was on top of the Burj Khalifa. I think that's where that hotel was on fire, I think, last night. And then also... I mean, I would definitely be scared if I saw these things. So a lot of people have taken this story And I've seen people take the story about the selfies, and they try to use it to say that we're too self-centered as a culture. Mm-hmm. And well, I guess maybe we are, but and we spend too much time on our smartphones, but I guess we all have one here with us.
Well, you know, on the selfies today, though, Jeff, I mean, yeah, when we didn't have our phones, we took pictures. We just had to wait longer. You couldn't post them online. You could only, you know, actually post them on your wall.
Yeah, you can do a selfie with a Polaroid.
There you go.
Oh, that's right. And, you know, come out and you have to shake it off.
Make sure those little, yeah.
Look at it. So you could still take selfies, but it's a lot easier now. But I remember when it wasn't uncommon to see several people. Like you would go into to a restaurant, they would be on their reading a newspaper or a magazine, mm-hmm, on their lunch break. Mm-hmm. And so they're self-absorbed in the newspaper or the magazine. But now people, if you go to a restaurant, they're looking at their phones.
Yeah, sure. I read my Bible on my phone or my iPad.
Yeah, because a lot of times I'll be at church and I'll be giving a sermon. I'll look out and everybody's on their phones. And I hope that they're on the Bible. That's what I'm telling myself.
I always am. I'm not checking.
They're not texting somebody saying, oh,
people online
soon.
Do not drag me out.
But in many ways, this technology is bringing us closer together. In some ways, right? So there's some negative things, but you know, we communicate more often.
Right.
I just got a text from my parents. Said there was a knocking noise here. So I don't know where that's at. But
uh-oh,
if you hear a knocking noise, I guess
we're not letting anybody in.
So we communicate more often sometimes with people we may never, a lot of people we don't even communicate with. Like, I mean, how many Facebook friends do you have?
Oh, I don't know.
You have a lot, like hundreds.
Yeah, I do have
hundreds.
A lot.
I mean,
yeah.
And there's people we would have never communicated, sure, with before. Sure. I mean, there's people.
Well, and I have friends from high school that were connected on Facebook that I wouldn't be writing them letters or calling them on the phone, but I can see, you know, their grandchildren and stuff like,
yeah,
that.
Yeah, I like the people who are watching right now.
Right,
I know them on Facebook, and now, you know, we can become friends. Well, that wouldn't have happened before,
sure,
if it wasn't,
sure,
for this technology. So there's bad uses of technology, mm-hmm, but there's also good uses. We got the Bible apps. Great technology, Bible app, mm-hmm, and people watching us now or maybe watching on their phones, and so, you know, they're maybe self-absorbed. I hope they're absorbed with the bring on the Sabbath right now.
They're bring on the Sabbath absorbed.
Over half the people who visit the website here are on their phones.
Wow.
And I think that's a positive, that instead of maybe demonizing all smartphones as the next downfall of society, that we should. You know, we should say, hey, maybe there's good and there is bad. So now I have a selfie video I was going to play. That amazing selfie video.
Amazing.
From the feast I wanted to play here. So let me see if I can get this to play.
See Jeff.
All right. Amazing. All right.
Oh, wait. I'm sorry. That was the wrong video.
I was going to say, maybe need a little shade.
Even worse.
Okay, wait. I think I hit the wrong button there.
Hit the right selfie video.
I don't know what I was doing on the computer there. All right, here we go. All right, here's my selfie. I mean, I did the selfie video at the feast because I was actually walking around with my camera filming people,
yeah,
and they made a joke from the pulpit. Oh, Jeff's out there taking selfies. I said, well, if he's making a joke about it, I'm going to do it.
There you go.
So here we go. I think I have it queued up right now.
All right, great job.
That was in Florida, the feast site in St. Pete.
Oh, cool. That was great.
Yeah, and you got anything else to add to this? I mean, it's really kind of a silly story, but I didn't, you know, the point is that I'm happy, you know, that we have all this, we can communicate with so many people, and we're doing this tonight, which is, you know, amazing.
That's right.
That this technology
That's right. Connecting
exists.
To all these people and all over the country and the world. So here's a couple of things. Anyone could tell you getting run over by a truck because you were taking a selfie and not paying attention is something that you should avoid, because it's going to reduce your opportunities to serve God and your fellow man. You're going to need to be served, right? Uh-huh. Or you'll be dead. If your parents have not told you, folks, if there's anybody young watching, if your parents have not told you that everything you post on the internet lasts forever, so be careful, then perhaps you need new parents, right? So, you know, those are obvious things. What we want you to know is that God sees what you do, whether you post it on social media or not. I don't just mean the bad things. I mean, especially the good things. You know, the Gen X values
Generation X folks and millennials value service to others. And we know you're out there serving. Some of them give up their Saturdays, you know, it's sports to do stuff. Some of them, you know, serve at church and all. So we know you're out there serving and giving lots of different, in lots of different ways. God sees that too.
Yeah.
And if you don't have a place to serve, contact us here at CGI. Call Jeff, write us, let us know in the chat. We can probably give you opportunities to serve.
Okay, good. All right. Let's see. Should we take a break now? Are we ready for a break?
We have a break here. We can take a break.
Okay, we'll be right back. Don't go away. We're going to be right back.
Hi, I'm Wes White, and welcome to another program of Bible Q&A on CGI.org. We have a question from someone who asks, was the Apostle Paul anti-woman? In short, the answer to that is Paul absolutely was not anti-woman. And let's look at what the Bible tells us about Paul. We're going to read some scriptures. When we look at the writings of Paul, the first thing that we find is that women labored side by side with Paul. In Philippians 4:3, it tells us, "And I entreat thee also, true yoke fellow, help those women which labored with me in the gospel, and with Clement also, and with my other fellow laborers whose names are in the book of life." And it's clear that Paul was giving equal recognition to the women who served the church. When some say that Paul was anti-woman, they ignore his greetings and commendations that he's given to women in Romans 16. Let's read just a few of them. Verse 1, it says, "I commend unto you Phoebe, our sister, which is a servant of the church, which is at Cenchrea, that you receive her in the Lord as become a saints, and that you assist her in whatsoever business she hath need of you." Paul is asking them to give her a blank check. Give her whatever she needs. Verse 3, it says, "Greet Priscilla and Aquila, my helpers in Christ Jesus, who have for my life laid down their own necks, unto whom not only I give thanks, but also all the churches of the Gentiles." Verse 6, he says, "Greet Mary, who bestowed much labor on us." Verse 12, "Salute Tryphena and Tryphosa, who labor in the Lord. Salute the beloved Persis, which labored much in the Lord." In verse 15, he says, "Salute Philologus and Julia and Nereus and his sister and Olympus and all the saints which are with them." Paul was not anti-woman. Paul used women as he preached the gospel. And Romans 16 is a who's who of men and women who labor together for the Lord. Women were an important part of Paul's ministry. Paul did not exclude women from participating in church affairs. There are so many places in Scripture, Old Testament and New Testament, that show how women played extremely important roles in the temple, in the tabernacle, and in the New Testament. We find a woman playing an extremely pivotal role in turning the nation of Israel back to God. And chances are good that you haven't heard of these women. Chances are what the Bible says about women is not what you think. So maybe you need to request our message that's entitled, "The Role of Women in the Church." This message is free. Why don't you ask for it? We'd be glad to give it to you. And we'll see you next time on Bible Q&A at CGI.org. In the meantime, please keep reading your Bible and please keep asking questions.
Don Henley once wrote these words, "All this fighting over who will be anointed. How can people be so blind? What does it mean to be an anointed Messiah? God once promised that King David's kingdom would endure forever. God promised that David's throne would endure forever, and that this kingdom would have dominion over all the earth. But people usually don't like to talk about an anointed Messiah ruling the earth. Instead, they want to think about going to heaven to be with Jesus after they die. We want to help you understand this issue better. Ask for our free booklet, Messiah. You can get it on CGI.org. It's free. Again, read our booklet, Messiah, on CGI.org.
Hey, we want to thank you so much for being with us. We have talked way too much. It's been over an hour of the show, so an hour and 10 minutes. We got a lot more material that we wanted to cover, but come back next week at 7:30 and see the show. We want to share this with you every Friday night. We'll see you next Friday night. Thanks for watching us. 7:30 Central Time. Bring on the Sabbath. In the meantime, say it with me.
Have a good Sabbath.
Wow.
All right.